final night of Uncle Vanya. I have a few announcements to make. Due to the site-specific nature of this performance, you will be asked to move throughout the space. The ushers, or the three of us, will be, or me and Chelsea, are going to be guiding you and directing you where to sit and stand once we get inside. Due to the very small space that we're working in, you are going to be very close quarters with your fellow audience members. I hope that's okay. If an actor needs to get by you at some point, just quietly move aside, let them do their thing, and then when they're done, just quietly go back to where you were. This show features the use of a prop gun as well as a gun sound effect. The show should run approximately an hour and a half. Please take this time right now to turn off or silence your cell phones. Very important. If you borrowed an umbrella, just make sure you give it back at the end, although I don't think anyone did. And that's all. Thank you, and enjoy the show.
Don't seem to want any.
Then will you have a drop of vodka instead?
No, I don't drink vodka every day, and besides, it's too hot. Tell me, nurse, how long is it that we've known each other?
Well, let me see, how long is it? Lord, help me to remember. You first came here into our parts. Let me think. It was 11 years ago. Perhaps more.
Have I changed much since then?
Oh, yes. You were handsome and young then, and now you are an old man and not handsome anymore. And you drink, too.
Yes. 10 years have made me another man. And why? Because I am overworked. Nurse. I am on my feet from dawn until dusk. I know no rest. At night, I tremble under my blankets for fear of being dragged off to visit someone who is sick. I have toiled without repose or a day's freedom since I have known you. Could I help growing old? An existence is tedious anyway. It is a senseless, dirty business, this life, and goes heavily. Everyone about here is silly. And after living with them for 2 or 3 years, one becomes silly oneself. It is inevitable. See what a long beard I have grown? A silly, foolish, long beard. Yes, I am as silly as the rest, nurse, but not as stupid. No, I have not grown stupid. Thank God my brain is not addled yet. Though my feelings have grown numb, I ask nothing. I need nothing. I love no one. Unless it is yourself alone.
Don't you want a bite of something to eat?
No. In February. During the third week of Lent, I went to the epidemic at Mellert. It was eruptive typhoid. The peasants were all lying side by side in their huts, and the calves and pigs ran about the floor among the sick. Such dirt there was, and smoke unspeakable. I slaved among those people all day, not a crumb passed my lips. But then, when I returned home, there was still no rest for me. A switch man was carried in from the railroad. I laid him on the operating table, and he died in my arms. Under chloroform. And then my feelings, which should have been deadened, awoke again. My conscience tortured me as if I had killed the man. I sat down, closed my eyes like this, and thought, will our descendants, 200 years from now, for whom we are breaking the road, remember to give us a kind word? No, nurse, they will forget.
Man is forgetful. But God remembers!
Thank you for that. You have spoken the truth.
Yes. Yes.
Have you been asleep?
Yes, very much so. Ever since the professor and his wife have come, daily life seems to have jump the track. I sleep at the wrong times, drink wine, and eat all sorts of messes for lunch and dinner. It isn't wholesome. Sonia and I used to work together, and we never had an idle moment. And now Sonia works alone, and all I do is eat, drink, and sleep. Something is wrong.
Such a confusion in the house. The professor! 12. Everything has to be prepared all morning for him. Before they came here, we used to have dinner at 1, like everybody else. But now we have it at 7. The professor sits up all night, writing, reading, and suddenly, at 2:00, there goes the bell. Heavens, what can that be? Wake the servants, light the samovar. The professor wants some tea. Disorder. Look at this! The samovar has been on the table for 2 hours. And they've all been out walking.
All right, don't get excited. Here they come.
Superb! Superb! What beautiful ears. They are wonderful, Your Excellency.
Tomorrow we shall go into the woods. Shall we, Professor?
Ladies and gentlemen, tea is ready.
If you'd be so kind as to take my tea into the library, I still have some work to finish.
I am sure you will love the woods.
Is our learned scholar on a hot, sultry day like this, wearing his galoshes in his overcoat and carrying an umbrella.
He is trying to take good care of his health.
Never in my life have I seen a more beautiful woman. How lovely she is.
Do you know, Marina, that as I walk through these fields or the shady garden, as I look upon this table here, my heart is filled with an unbounded happiness. The weather is enchanting, the birds are singing, and we are all living in perfect peace and contentment. What more could the soul desire?
Such eyes! A glorious woman.
Come, Yvonne, tell us something.
What shall I tell you?
Haven't you any news for us?
No. It is all stale. I'm just the same as usual, perhaps worse, because I have grown lazy. All I do now is croak like an old raven.
And the professor?
The professor sits in his office, morning till night as usual, straining the mind, wrinkling the brow, we write, without respite for hope or praise in the future or now. Poor paper. For years he's been chewing on other men's thoughts, on realism, naturalism, and all such foolishness. And he's been reading and writing the thoughts that clever men already know and stupid ones are not interested. And yet, see him, stalking across the earth like a demigod.
I believe you envy him.
I do. Look at the success he has had with women. Don himself was not more favored. His first wife was a beautiful, gentle being, as pure as the blue sky there is above us. His second wife is, as you see, brilliant and beautiful. She married him in his old age and has sacrificed all the glory of her youth to him. Why? What for?
Is she faithful to him?
Yes, unfortunately she is.
Why unfortunate?
Because such fidelity is false and unnatural, root and branch. It is thought immoral for a woman to deceive an old husband whom she hates, but quite moral for her to bury her youth into her breast and banish every vital desire from her heart?
No, Vanya, I don't like to hear you talk so. Listen, Vanya, everyone who betrays husband or wife is faithless and could also betray one's country.
Turn off the tap, Waffles.
No, allow me, Vanya. My wife ran away with a lover on the day after our wedding because my exterior was unprepossessing. I love her and am faithful to this day. I have not failed in my duty since then. I have given my fortune to help educate the daughter of herself and her lover.
No.
I have sacrificed my happiness, but I have kept my pride. And she? Her youth has fled, her beauty has faded according to the laws of nature, and her lover is dead. What does she care?
I have come to see your husband. You wrote me saying he had rheumatism, and I know not what else, and that he was really ill, but he appears to be as lively as a cricket.
He had a fit of the blues yesterday evening and complained of pains in his legs, but he seems to be all right again.
Well, and I galloped over here 20 miles at breakneck speed. No matter, though, it is not the first time. Once here, however, I'll at least stay the night, and at any rate, sleep. Quantum satis.
Oh, splendid! You so seldom spend the night. Have you had dinner yet?
No.
Good. You'll have it with us then.
Yes, the samovar has grown cold.
Don't mind, Monsieur Ian. We will drink cold tea, then.
I beg your pardon, ma'am, but my name is not Ian. It's Ilya. As in Ilya Telegin? Or Waffles, as I am so often called on account of my pockmarked face? Your husband, His Excellency, knows me very well, and I am Sonia's godfather. I now live with you here on this estate, and perhaps you would be so good as to notice I dine with you every day.
He is our great help, our right-hand man. Come, dear godfather, let me pour you some tea.
What a fine day! Not too hot.
Fine day to hang oneself.
There's nothing for it but to go. Damn it, this is annoying.
Oh, it is too bad, really. You must come back to dinner from after at the factory.
No, I won't be able to do that. It'll be too late. We're... Look here, my good man. Get me a glass of vodka, will you? I I should be really delighted if you would come visit me someday with Miss Sonia. My estate is small, but if you should be interested in such things, I should like to show you a nursery and seedbed, the like of whose you will not find within 1,000 miles of here. My place is small and is surrounded by government forests, and the forester is old and ailing, so I superintend most of the work myself.
I have always heard that you were very fond of the woods. Of course, one can do a great deal of good by helping to preserve them, but does not that work interfere with your real calling?
God alone knows what a man's real calling is.
And do you find it interesting?
Yes, very.
Oh, extremely.
You are still young, not over 36 or 7, I should think. And I suspect that the woods do not interest you as much as you say they do. I should think you would find them monotonous.
No! The work is thrilling. Doctor, ASTROV watches over the old woods and sets out new plantations every year. He has already received a diploma and a bronze medal. And if you will listen to all he can tell you, I'm sure you'll agree with him entirely. He says that forests are the ornaments of the earth and that they teach mankind to understand beauty and attune his mind to lofty sentiments. Forests temper a stern climate, and in locations where the climate is milder, less strength is wasted in the battle with humanity and nature. He says that the inhabitants of such countries are kind and gentle, and that they are handsome, tractable, sensitive. They're graceful in speech and gesture, and their philosophies are joyous, and art and science blossom among them. The treatment of women is full of exquisite
nobility. Bravo! All that is very pretty, but it is also unconvincing. Now, my friend, you must let me go on building my sheds of planks and burning firewood in my stoves.
You can burn peat in your stoves and build your sheds of stone. Of course, I do not object to cutting wood from necessity, but why destroy the forests? You do not take what I'm saying seriously. However, I must be off. Probably it is all nonsense anyway.
When will you come back to school?
I can't say.
In a month?
You have behaved shockingly again. At breakfast, you argued with Alexander. Really, your behavior is too petty.
But if I hate him?
You hate Alexander for no reason. He is like everyone else and no worse than you are.
If only you could see your face, your gestures, how tedious your life must be.
It is tedious, yes, and dreary. You all abuse my husband and look on me with compassion. You think, poor woman, she is married to an old man. How well I understand your compassion. As ASTROV said just now, see how you thoughtlessly destroy the forest so that soon there will be none left. So also, you destroy mankind. And soon, fidelity and purity and self-sacrifice will have vanished with the woods. Why cannot you look calmly on a woman unless she is yours? Because the doctor was right. You are all possessed by a devil of destruction. You have no mercy on the woods or on birds or on women or on one another.
I don't like your philosophy.
That doctor has a sensitive, weary face. An interesting face. Sonia evidently likes him, and she is in love with him, and I can understand it. I haven't had a real talk with him yet, or made much of him. He thinks I'm disagreeable. Do you know, Ivan, the reason you and I are such friends? I think it is because we are both lonely and unfortunate. Yes, unfortunate. Don't look at me like that, I don't like it.
How can I look at you otherwise when I love you? You are my joy, my life, my youth. I know my chances of being with you are infinitely small. Do not exist. Just let me look at you and listen to your voice.
Hush, someone will overhear you.
Let me speak to you of my love. Don't drive me away. This alone will be my greatest happiness.
This is agony.
Who's there? Is it you, Sonia?
It is I.
Oh, it's you, Nelly. Oh. Oh, this pain is intolerable.
Your blanket has slipped down. Let me shut the window.
No, leave it open. I'm suffocating. I dreamt that my left leg belonged to someone else. It hurt so much that I woke. I don't think this is gout. It's more like, rheumatism. What time is it?
12:30.
Why do I find it so hard to breathe?
You're tired. This is the second night you've had no sleep.
I think I'm getting mononucleosis. Oh, damn this horrible, accursed old age. Ever since I've become old, I've become hateful to myself and to you all as well, I'm sure.
You speak as if we were to blame for your being old.
No, oh, I'm more hateful to you than to anyone. You're quite right, of course. I can understand you. I'm not an idiot. You're young and healthy and beautiful and longing for life, and I'm an old dotard, almost a dead man already. Don't I know it? Of course I can see how foolish it is for me to go on living, but just wait. Soon I shall set you all free. My life cannot go on much longer.
Be quiet, for God's sake. You are overtaxing my powers of endurance.
It's funny how everybody listens to Ivan, but the moment I open my lips, you all begin to feel ill-treated. You can't even stand the sound of my voice. Even if I am a selfish tyrant, haven't I the right to be one at my age, I ask you? Haven't I deserved it? Haven't I the right to be respected now that I am old?
No one is disputing your rights! The wind is rising. I should shut the window. It's going to rain. Your rights have never been questioned by anyone.
I spent my life working in the interest of learning. I am used to my library and the lecture hall and the esteem and admiration of my colleagues. And now suddenly, I find myself plunged into this wilderness, condemned to see the same stupid people from morning till night and listen to their futile conversations. And I want to live. I long for fame and success and the stir of the world. And here I am in exile. Oh, it is dreadful to have nothing to do but sit here grieving for the lost past, to see the success of others, and have nothing to do but fear death. It's more than I can bear. I cannot stand it, and you won't even forgive me for being old?
Wait! Have patience. I shall be old myself in 4 or 5 years.
Father, you sent for Dr. Astroff, and now when he comes, you refuse to see him. It's not nice to give a man so much trouble for nothing.
What do I care about your Astroff? That man understands medicine about as well as I understand astronomy.
Can't send for the whole medical faculty, can we, to treat your gout?
I won't talk to that madman.
Do as you please. It's all the same to me.
What time is it?
1:00.
Sonia, will you hand me that bottle in the kitchen?
Here it is.
Oh, not that one. Can't you understand me? Can't I ask you to do a thing?
Please, don't be capricious with me. Some people might like it, but spare me if you please, because I do not. Besides, I haven't the time. I am counting hay tomorrow, and I must get up early.
Arms coming.
There it is. Helen and Sonia, go to bed. I've taken your place.
No. Don't leave me with him. He'll talk me to death.
Oh, but you must let them go to sleep. They have not slept for 2 nights.
Oh, well, let them go to bed, but you go away too. Do not protest against going. For the sake of our former friendship,
our
do not.
Our former friendship.
My darling, don't leave me alone with him. He'll talk me to death.
This is ridiculous.
Go to bed, nurse. It's late.
Haven't cleared away the tea things yet. Can't go to bed yet.
No, can't go to bed. None of them can go to bed. They're all worn out, but only I enjoy perfect happiness.
What's the matter, Master? Does it hurt? My own legs ache so badly. You've had this illness such a long time. My own feet ache so badly. Oh, so badly. Come, come, master.
No.
He has exhausted me. I can barely stand.
He's exhausted you, and I've exhausted myself. I have not slept for 3 nights.
Something is wrong in this house. The professor is vexed. He won't trust me and fears you. Sonia is angry with her father and with me. She hasn't spoken to me for 2 weeks. I am at the end of my strength and have come near bursting into tears at least 20 times today. Something is wrong in this house.
Leave speculating alone.
You are cultured and intelligent, Yvonne, and you surely understand that the world is not destroyed by villains and fires, but by hate and malice and all this spiteful tattling. It is your duty to make peace and not to growl at everything.
Then help me to first make peace with myself, my darling, but please.
Go away.
Soon the rain will be over, and nature will sigh and awake refreshed, only I am not refreshed by the storm. Day and night the thought haunts me like a fiend that soon my life will be lost forever. This wonderful feeling of mine, like a ray of sunlight, will be lost and fall into a dark chasm, and I fear my life will go with it.
I am stupefied when you speak to me of your love and don't know how to answer you. Forgive me, I have nothing to say to you. Good night.
If you only knew how I am tortured by the fact that there's another life that is being lost forever in this house, it is yours. What are you waiting for? Understand.
Ivan, you're drunk.
Perhaps. perhaps.
Where is the doctor?
In there, spending the night with me. Perhaps I am drunk. Perhaps I am. Nothing's impossible.
We've just been drinking together. Why do you do that?
Because it feels like life, at least. Don't stop me, Helena.
You never used to drink. And you never used to talk so much. Go to bed. I'm tired of you.
My sweetheart, are you talking?
Leave me alone. Really, this is getting disgusting.
She is gone. I met her first years ago. Why did I not fall in love with her then? It would have been easy. And now, we both would have both been awakened by this thunderstorm. And I would have held her in my arms and whispered, "Don't be afraid, I am here." Oh, enchanting dream, so sweet that I laugh to think of it. I hate that rhetoric of hers, that morality of indolence, that absurd talk of the destruction of the world. Oh, how I have been deceived. For years I worshipped that miserable Galbraith professor, and Sonia and I have squeezed this estate dry for his sake. We have bartered our butter and peas like misers and never kept a morsel for ourselves. We have only scraped enough pennies together to send to him. And now, his fame has burst like a soap bubble. I can see that I have been basely deceived. I can see that now. Basely deceived.
Clay! But everyone in the house is asleep.
Clay!
Are you alone here? No women about? The hunt is cold, the fire is dead. Where shall the master lay his head? The thunderstorm woke me. It was a heavy shower. What time is it?
The devil only knows.
I thought I heard Helena's voice.
She was here a moment ago.
What a beautiful woman. Medicine, is it? What a variety we have. Prescriptions from Moscow? From Kharkov? And from Tula. Why, he's been pestering all the towns of Russia with his gout. Is he ill or simply shamming?
He's really ill.
What is the matter with you today? You seem sad. Is it because you're sorry for the professor?
Leave me alone.
Or in love with the professor's wife.
She's my friend.
Already?
What do you mean by already?
A woman can only become a man's friend when he has first been his acquaintance, then his lover, then she can become his friend.
Vulgar philosophy.
What do you mean? Yes, I must admit, I am getting vulgar, but then, you see, I am drunk. I usually only drink like this once a month. At such times, my audacity and temerity know no bounds. I feel capable of anything. I attempt the most difficult operations and perform them magnificently. The most brilliant plans for the future take shape in my head. I am no longer a poor fool of a doctor, but mankind's greatest benefactor. I evolve my own systems of philosophy, and all of you seem to crawl at my feet like so many insects or microbes. Play Waffles! Play!
My dear boy, I would with all my heart, but please do listen to reason. Everyone in the house is asleep.
Play! I want to drink some more. Come, we still have some brandy left, and once it is morning, you will come home with me. Wild thing, you make my heart sing. You make everything groovy. Wild thing, I think I love you. You make everything groovy, groovy, wild thing. You make my heart sing. You make everything groovy, groovy, wild thing. You make my heart sing. You make everything groovy. Wild thing. I think I love you. I wanna know for sure. I beg your pardon? I have no collar on.
Uncle, you and the doctor have been drinking. The good fellows have been getting together. It's all very well for him. He has always done it, but why do you follow his example? It looks dreadfully at your age.
Because age has nothing to do with it. When life is wanting, one must create an illusion. It is better than nothing.
My heart is bursting. It is awful.
No matter, though, I must go.
Dr. Astroff, are you awake? Please come here for a minute.
In a moment.
Okay.
Hello?
Won't you have a bite to eat?
Yes, please. I believe I will.
I love to eat at night. I'm sure we'll find something in here. You know, they say that my father's made a great many conquests in his life and that the women have spoiled him. There's some cheese for you.
I haven't eaten anything today. Your father has a very difficult nature. May I? We're alone here and can speak freely. Do you know, I could not stand living in this house for even a month. I mean, this atmosphere would stifle me. There's your father, entirely absorbed in his books and his gout. There's your uncle Vanya with his hypochondria. And finally, there's your stepmother.
What about her?
A human being should be entirely beautiful. The face, the mind, the clothes, the thoughts. Your stepmother, as you can see, is of course beautiful to look at. But don't you see, she does nothing but eat and sleep and walk and bewitch us. And that is all. She has no responsibilities. Everything is done for her, am I not right? And an idle life can never be a pure one. However, I may be judging her too severely. Like your Uncle Vanya, I am discontented, and so we are both grumblers.
Are you not satisfied with life?
I like life as life. But as far as my own personal life goes, there is absolutely no redeeming feature about it. Haven't you noticed? When you were riding through a dark wood late at night and you see a little light ahead, how you seem to forget your fatigue and the darkness and the sharp twigs that whip in your face. I work, that you know, as no one in the county works. Fate beats me on without rest. The times I suffer unendurably and I see no light ahead. I have no hope. I don't like people. It's been long since I've loved anyone.
You love no one?
Not a soul. I only feel a sort of tenderness for your old nurse for old time's sake. The peasants are all stupid and live in dirt. And the educated people are hard to get along with. One grows tired of them. All of our friends are petty and shallow and see no farther than their own noses. In one word, they are dull. Those that have brains are hysterical, they're devoured with a mania for self-analysis. They hate and they whine and they pick faults everywhere with unnecessary sharpness.
They look at me out of the corner, sneak up to me and look at me out of the corner of their eye and say, that man is a lunatic. That man is a windbag. They don't know what to label me as. They say I'm strange. I like the woods. That is strange. I don't eat meat. That is strange, too. Simple, natural relations between man and man and man and nature do not exist.
I beg you, I implore you not to drink anymore.
Why not?
It's so unworthy of you. You're well-bred, your voice is sweet, and you're more than anyone else I know. And why do you want to resemble the common people who drink and play cards? Don't, I beg you. You know how you used to say that man never creates anything but only destroys what heaven has given them. Why do you want to destroy yourself? I implore you, I entreat you.
I won't drink anymore.
Promise me.
I give you my word of honor.
Thank you.
You see? I have done with it. There. I am perfectly sober once more. And so I shall stay till the end of my life. But as I was saying, life holds nothing for me. My race is run. I'm old. I'm tired. I am trivial. My sensibilities are dead. I could never attach myself to anyone again. I love no one and never shall. Beauty alone has the power to touch me still. I'm deeply moved by it. Helena could turn my head in a day if she wanted to, but that is not love. That is not affection.
What is it?
Nothing. In February, one of my patients died.
It's time to forget about that. Tell me, doctor, if I had a friend or a younger sister, and you knew that she, well, loved you, what would you do?
I don't imagine I should do anything. I should make her understand that I could not return her love. However, my mind is not bothered with those things now. I must start at once if I am to ever get off. Goodbye, my dear girl. We shall stand here talking all night. I shall exit through the sitting room. I'm afraid your uncle might detain me.
Not a word. His heart and soul are still locked for me, and yet, for some reason, I'm strangely happy. I wonder why. I told him that he was well-bred and handsome and that his voice was sweet. Was that a mistake? I still feel his voice vibrating in the air. It caresses me. How terrible it is to be plain. I'm plain, I know it. Last Sunday, I overheard someone say, What a dear, noble girl she is, but what a pity it is. She is so ugly. So ugly.
The storm is over. What delicious air! Where's the doctor?
He is gone.
Sonia!
Yes?
How much longer are you going to sulk at me? We haven't hurt each other. Why not be friends? We've had enough of this.
I've wanted... Yes, let us make peace.
With all my heart. There's some wine. Let us seal our friendship.
Yes, let us.
Out of one glass. So, are we friends?
Yes, I have long waited to make peace.
But somehow I was ashamed to. Why are you crying?
I don't know. It's nothing.
There. Don't cry. Silly. No, I am crying too. You were angry with me because I seemed to have married your father for his money, but don't believe the gossip that you hear. I swear to you, I married him for love. I was fascinated by his fame and learning. I know now that it was not real love, but it seemed real at the time. I am innocent, and yet your clever, suspicious eyes have been punishing me for an imaginary crime ever since my marriage.
Peace, peace, let us forget the past.
You must not look so on people. It is not becoming to you. You must trust people, or life becomes impossible.
Tell me truly, as a friend, are you happy?
Truly, no.
I knew it. One more question. Do you wish your husband were young?
What a child you are. Of course I do. Go on, ask another.
Do you like the doctor?
Yes, very much indeed.
I have a stupid face, haven't I? He's just gone out, but his voice is still in my ears. I hear his step. I see his face in a dark window. Let me say all I have in my heart. I can't. I'm ashamed. Come to my room later and talk to me there. Please talk to me of him.
What can I say?
He is clever. He can do everything. He can cure the sick. He can plant woods.
It is not a question of medicine and woods, my dear.
Yeah.
He is a man of genius. Do you know what that means? It means that he is brave, profound, and of clear insight. He plants a tree and his mind travels 1,000 years into the future and he sees visions of the happiness of the human race. People like him are rare and should be loved. When you come to think of it, Sonia, I'm really very, very unhappy. Happiness can never exist for me in this world. Ever. Why do you laugh?
I'm so happy. So happy.
I want to hear music. I might play a little.
Oh, do play. Do play. I could not possibly go to sleep now.
Yes, I will. Your father is still awake, and music irritates him when he is ill. If he says that I may, then I shall. Go, Sonia, and ask him.
Very well.
It is so long since I have heard music, and now I shall sit and play and weep like a fool. Micah, is that you rattling out there?
It is I.
Don't make such a noise. Your master is ill.
I'm leaving now.
He says no.
Hey, now, take the pills and the heels.
his life, called his wife in. Nothing to say, but what a day. How's your boy been? Nothing to do, it's up to you.
It seems he has some communication to make with the world.
Probably a matter of business.
He's never had any business. He grumbles, writes twaddle, and eats his heart out with jealousy. That's all he does.
Uncle!
I beg your pardon. Look at her, wandering up and down from sheer idleness. Sweet picture, really.
I wonder you are not bored, droning on in the same key from morning till night. Ugh, I am dying of this tedium! What shall I do?
There's plenty to do if you would.
For instance?
You could help run this place. You could teach the children, care for the sick. Isn't that enough? Before you and Papa came, Uncle Vanya and I used to go to the market ourselves and deal in flour.
I don't know anything about such things, and besides, they don't interest me. It is only in novels that women go out and teach and heal the peasants. How can I suddenly begin to do it?
Oh, don't be sad, dearest. You're miserable and restless and can't seem to fit into this life. Your restlessness is catching. Look at Uncle Vanya. All he does anymore is haunt you like a shadow. Uncle Vanya? Dr. Astroff hardly ever used to come here, and it was all we could do to persuade him to visit us once a month. And now he has abandoned his forestry and his practice. Right, Uncle Vanya? You must be a witch.
Why must you languish here? Come, my dearest, my sweet, be sensible. The blood of a mermaid runs in your veins. Let yourself be one. Give nature the reins for once in your life and fall head over ears in love with some water sprite and plunge headfirst into a deep pool so that Herr Professor and all of us may have our hands free again.
Leave me alone. How cruel you are.
My sweet, my beauty, I apologize. Forgive me.
Confess that you would try the patience of an angel.
All right. As a peace offering, I will fetch you some flowers that I picked for you this morning. Some autumn roses, beautiful, sorrowful roses.
Autumn roses, beautiful, sorrowful roses.
Where's the doctor?
He's writing in Uncle Vanya's room. Listen, I'm glad Uncle Vanya went out. I, want to talk to you about something.
About what?
About what?
There. That will do. Don't, Sonia.
I'm ugly.
You have lovely hair.
Don't say that. No, whenever a woman is ugly, they always say that she has beautiful hair or eyes. I have loved him. I have loved him more than one loves one's own mother. And as you can see, I always run to you to talk of him. His voice is always with me. If I look up, I seem to see him coming. He is here every day now, but he doesn't notice me. He does not recognize my presence. It is agony. I have no hope. No hope. Yesterday I told Uncle Vanya. I couldn't help myself. Everyone knows I love him.
Does he?
No, he doesn't notice me.
He is a strange man. Listen, Sonia, will you allow me to speak to him? I shall be careful, only hint. Really, to be an uncertainty all this time, let me do it. Splendid. It will be easy to find out whether he loves you or not. Don't be ashamed, sweetheart. Don't worry. I shall be careful. He will not notice a thing. We only want to find out whether it is a yes or no, don't we? And if it is a no, then he must keep away from here. Is that so? It will be easier not to see him anymore. We won't put off the examination an instant. He said he had a sketch he wanted to show me. Go and tell him that I want to see him.
Will you tell me the whole truth?
Of course I will. I'm sure that no matter what it is, it will be easier to bear than this uncertainty. Trust me, dearest.
Yes, I shall say that you'd like to see a sketch.
No, it's better not to know. Yet there may be hope.
What do you say?
Nothing.
There is no greater sorrow than to know another's secret when you cannot help them. He is obviously not in love with her, but I can understand how the poor girl feels. She lives here in this desperate loneliness with no one around her except these colorless shadows who go mooning about, talking nonsense, and knowing nothing except that they eat, drink, and sleep. Among them appears, from time to time, this Dr. Astroff. So different, so handsome, so interesting, so charming. It is like seeing the moon rise on a dark night. Oh, to surrender oneself to his embrace, to lose oneself in his arms! I'm a little in love with him myself. But I'm a coward. I'm afraid. My conscience torments me. He stays here. I can guess why. I feel guilty already. I should like to fall on my knees at Sonia's feet and beg her forgiveness and weep.
How do you do? Would you like to see my sketches?
Yes, you said you would show me what you've been working on. Have you time now?
Of course I have. Where were you born?
In St. Petersburg.
And educated?
At the conservatory there.
This life doesn't interest you much, I dare say.
Oh, why not? It is true that I don't know the country very well, but I have read a great deal about it.
Look here. This is a map of our county as it was 50 years ago. The green tints, both dark and light, represent forests. As you can see, half of the map is covered with them. Now here is a map of our country as it was 25 years ago. Only a third of the map is now green with forests. Now we get to the third part. Our country as it appears today. We still see spots of green, but on the whole, not much. It is overall a picture of a regular and slow decline that evidently it will take maybe 15, 10 more years to complete. You may perhaps object that it is the march of progress that the old order must give place to the new, and you might be right if roads had been run through these broken woods, or if factories or schools had taken their place, the people would have then become richer and better educated and healthier. But as it is, we have nothing of the sort. We are confronted by the degradation of our country, brought on by the intense struggle for existence of the human race is the consequence of the ignorance and unconsciousness of starving, shivering, sick humanity that, to save its children, snatches at all that can warm it and still its hunger, so it destroys everything without a thought for the morrow. And almost everything is gone and nothing has been created to take its place. But I can see by your face that I'm not interesting you.
I know so little about such things.
No, there's nothing to know. It simply isn't interesting, that's all.
Frankly, my thoughts were elsewhere. Forgive me. I want to submit to you a little examination, but I am embarrassed and don't know how to begin.
An examination?
Yes, but quite an innocent one. Sit down. It is about a certain young girl I know. Let us discuss it like honest people, like friends, and then forget what has passed between us, shall we?
Very well.
It is about my stepdaughter, Sonia. Do you like her?
Yes, I respect her.
Do you like her as a woman?
No.
One more word and that will be the last. You have not noticed anything?
No, nothing.
You do not love her. I can see that in your eyes. You must realize that she is suffering and not come here anymore.
Yes, my sun has set and I haven't the time.
Where shall I find time for such things?
Ma, what unpleasant conversation! I am as out of breath as if I had been running 3 miles uphill. Thank heavens that is over. Now let us forget everything as if nothing has passed between us, shall we? You are sensible, you understand. I'm actually blushing.
If you had spoken a month ago, I might have perhaps considered it, but now, of course, if she is suffering. But I still cannot understand why you had to put me through this examination. Oh, you are wily.
What does that mean?
You are a wily one. I admit that Sonia is suffering, but what does this examination of yours mean? Don't give me that look of surprise. You know perfectly well why I'm here. Yes, you know for whose sake I come. Oh, my sweet tigress. Don't give me that look, I'm an old bird.
A tigress? I don't understand you.
Beautiful, sleek tigress, you must have your victims. I've thrown over everything for you, and you love to see it. Now, we're sure you knew this without putting me through your little examination. I surrender. You have me. Now, eat me.
You have gone mad.
You are afraid.
I am a better and stronger woman than you think me. Goodbye.
Why goodbye? Don't say goodbye. Don't waste words. How lovely you are. What hands?
Enough of this. Leave the room. You have forgotten yourself.
Tell me. Tell me, where can we meet tomorrow? Don't you see that we must meet? That it is inevitable?
Have pity, leave me. Don't.
Be in the forest tomorrow at 2:00. Will you? Will you?
Let me go! This is appalling.
Nothing. Yes.
No!
Nothing.
The weather is fine. my dear Ivan, the morning was overcast and it looked like rain, but now the sun is shining again. Honestly, we've had a very fine autumn. The wheat is looking fairly well. But the days are growing short.
You must use all your power. You must do your very best to get my husband and myself away from here. Do you hear? I say this very day.
Helena, I saw everything.
Do you hear me? I must leave here this very day!
I'm not doing very well myself, Your Excellency! I have been limping for 2 days in my head!
Where are the others? Oh. I hate this house. It's a regular labyrinth! Everyone is always scattered around the 26 enormous rooms. One can never find a soul. Ask my wife to come in here.
I am here already.
Oh, please, be seated, all of you!
What did he say?
I'll tell you later.
You're moved. I understand. He said he would not come anymore.
One can, after all, become reconciled to becoming an invalid, but not, it seems, to this country life. The wheeze of it stick in my throat, and I feel as if I've been whirled off the earth and landed on some strange planet. Sit down, all of you! Sonia! Sonia, sit down! She does not hear me! Sonia! You sit down too, nurse! Ladies and gentlemen, I crave your indulgences. Hang your ears, if you will, on the peg of attention.
Perhaps you do not need me, may I be
excused? No, you are needed now more than anyone, ladies and gentlemen. I shall begin. I have asked you here in order to discuss a matter of great importance. I want to ask for your advice and assistance.
Oh, yes.
And knowing your unfailing amiability, I believe I can count on both.
Go faster!
I am a bookworm and a scholar.
And am unfamiliar with practical affairs. I cannot, I find, dispense with the well-informed opinions of you, Ivan, and you, Telegin! Telegin!
The truth is, merit omnes una nox. That is to say, our lives are in the hands of God, and as I'm old and ill, I realize that the time has come for me to dispense with my property with regard to the interests of my family. I'm not thinking of myself.
Yeah?
I have a young wife and daughter.
All right.
I cannot continue to live in the country. Oh, we were not made for country life. And yet, we cannot continue to live in town on the income derived from this estate. We might sell the woods, but that would be an expedient we could not resort to every year. We must find ourselves some way of guaranteeing a more or less fixed yearly income. With this object in view, a plan has occurred to me, which I have the honor presenting to you all for your consideration. I shall give you only a rough outline, avoiding all details. Our estate does not, on average, earn more than 2% on the money invested in it. I propose to sell it. If we then invest our capital in bonds, it will earn us 4-5%, and we should have a small surplus of several thousand rubles with which we could buy a summer cottage in Finland.
Oh, hold on.
I said we would sell it, buy bonds, and have a summer cottage in Finland!
No, not Finland! You said something else!
I propose to sell this place!
Uh-huh! That was it! So you're gonna sell the place? Splendid! The idea's a rich one! And what do you propose to do with me and Sally?
Oh, that'll be decided in due time! We can't do everything at once!
I have been foolish enough to imagine that this estate belonged to Sonia. My sister bought it. My father bought it as a wedding present for my sister, and I foolishly imagined that the estate would come down to her child.
Oh, of course it's Sonia's. Has anyone denied it? I don't want to sell it without Sonia's consent. On the contrary, what I'm doing is for Sonia's good. I can't imagine why you are so upset. I don't pretend that my scheme is an ideal one, and if you all protest, I shall not insist.
I not only harbor feelings of respect towards learning, Your Excellency, but I am drawn to it by family ties. You see, my brother's wife, Gregory, whom you may know, his name is Constantine Lagedemonov, and he was a magistrate. Oh.
Stop, Waffles. This is business. We will talk of that later. There. Now ask him what he
thinks. Oh, why should I ask questions? What good would it do?
The price was 95,000 rubles. My father paid 70 and left it then at 25. Now listen. Had I not renounced my inheritance in favor of my sister, whom I deeply loved, the place could have not been bought. And what is more, I worked for 10 years like an ox and paid off the debt.
I regret never having started this conversation.
Thanks entirely to my own personal efforts. This place is entirely clear of debts, and now, when I have grown old, you want to throw me out?
No, Vanya, don't! I can't stand it!
What do you want, anyway?
We used to think of you as almost superhuman, but now the scales have fallen from my eyes, and I see you as you truly are! Those books of yours, which I used to admire, are not worth one copper kopeck! You are a hoax!
Can't anyone give a stop? I'm going!
I then I command you to stop this instant!
I refuse! Wait! I have not done yet! You have wrecked my life! I have never lived! My best years are gone for nothing, have been ruined, thanks to you! You are my most bitter enemy!
I can't stand it! I am going!
My life is a failure. I am clever, brave, and strong. If I had lived a normal life, I might have become another Schopenhauer or Dostoevsky. I am losing my head. I am going crazy!
Nerds!
Oh, will anyone tell me what on earth is the matter with him? He comes to stay in the same house with me. His room is almost next door to mine! Had him take himself off to the village in the wing of the house, where I shall have to leave here at once. I will not stay here! What a perfectly dreadful man!
Papa, you must be kind to us! Remember? Remember? tonight. We are so unhappy. We've toiled without rest. He never spent a penny on us. We sent them all to you. We've not eaten the bread of idleness. I'm not saying this as I should like to, Papa, but you must understand us. You must be merciful to us.
For heaven's sake, Alexander, go and have a talk with him. Explain.
Oh, very well. I shall have a talk with him, but I won't apologize. I'm not angry. But you must believe that his behavior has been strange, to say the least. I'll go to him.
Be gentle. Try to quiet.
What the?
I'm nervous.
Oh, it's all right,
my baby. My geese have cackled. They will be still again. First they cackle, and then they stop. You're trembling all over as if you were freezing. There, my little orphan baby. God is merciful. A little linden tea, and all will be right again. See, the geese have all gone now. The devil take them!
Get them!
Oh, what was that?
All them! All them! All them! He's got that!
Let me go! Let me go!
Where's Nelly?
I didn't get him. He missed. Damnation! Damnation! To hell with him! What shall I do? What shall I do?
Oh, nurse. Oh.
quick, Marina, or we shall be called away to say goodbye before you have finished. Their carriage has already been ordered.
I am a little tired.
They're going to Kharkov to live.
They do well to go.
We've been frightened. The professor's wife won't stay here an hour longer. If we are going at all, let's be off at once, says she. We can go to Kharkov and look about us and send for our things. They're traveling light. It seems, Marina, that fate has decreed for them not to live here.
And quite rightly. What a storm they have just raised. It was shameful.
Yes, indeed. The scene was worthy of the brush of Ibizovsky.
I wish I had never laid eyes on them. But now, we shall have things as they were again. Tea at 8, dinner at 1, everything in order. As decent folks, as Christians like to have it. It's been a long time since I have eaten noodles.
Yes, we haven't had noodles for ages. Not for ages. This morning, Marina, when I was walking through the village, I heard one of the shopkeepers call after me, "Hey, you hanger-on!" I felt it bitterly.
Don't pay any attention, Master. We are all dependents on God. You and Sonia and all of us. Everyone must work. No one can sit idle. Where is Sonia?
In the garden with the doctor, looking for Ivan. They fear he may lay hands on himself.
Okay. Leave me alone. Go! Leave me if not but for an hour. I will not have you watching me like this.
All right, Vanya.
The gander cackles. Ho, ho, ho.
Leave me alone.
I would, and with the greatest pleasure. I ought to have gone long ago, but I shan't leave until you return what you took from me.
I took nothing.
I'm not jesting. I really must go. Don't detain me.
I took nothing of yours.
You didn't? Well, very well. Then I shall have to wait a little longer, but then you'll have to excuse me if I resort to force. We'll have to bind you and search you. I mean what I said.
Do as you please. I would have made such a fool of myself to shoot him and miss. I shall never forgive myself.
When the impulse came to shoot, you should have put a bullet through your own head.
Strange. I've attempted murder, and I'm not going to be arrested or brought to trial. That means they think me mad. Me, mad. Those who hide their worthlessness, their dullness, their crying heartlessness behind a professor's mask are sane. Those who marry old men and deceive them under the noses of all are sane. I saw you kissing. I saw you in each other's arms.
Yes, sir, I did kiss her, so there.
You must tell me something. How am I supposed to live? What am I to do for the rest of my days? If only I could awake some bright new morning and feel that the past had been forgotten and had vanished like smoke. Tell me, please, tell me how to begin.
What nonsense? What new life can you and I look forward to? We can have no hope.
None.
None. Of that, I am certain.
Tell me what to do. I feel such a burning pain here.
Stop. It may be that posterity, which will despise us for our blind and stupid lives, may find some road to happiness. But we, you and I, can have but one hope. The hope that we may be visited by visions. Perhaps pleasant ones. As we lie resting in our graves. Yes, there are only two intelligent, respectable men in this country. you and I had this life, this miserable life of ours, sucked us under. We've become as petty and contemptible as the rest. But don't try to distract me from my purpose. Return what you took from me.
I took nothing.
You took a little bottle of morphine out of my medicine case. Look, if you are so positively determined to put an end to your life, then go into the woods and shoot yourself there. Give up the morphine, or there'll be a lot of talk and guesswork. People will think I gave it to you. I don't fancy having to perform a post-mortem on you. You think I should find it interesting?
Leave me alone.
Sonia, your uncle stole a bottle of morphine out of my medicine case and won't give it up. Tell him that his actions are, well, unwise.
Uncle Vanya, did you take the morphine?
Yes, he took it, I'm absolutely certain.
Give it up. Why are you trying to frighten us? Give it up, Uncle Vanya. My misfortune is perhaps even greater than yours, but I am not plunged in despair. I endure my sorrow and shall endure it until my life comes to a natural end. You must endure yours too. Give it up, dear darling Uncle Vanya, give it up. You are so good. I am sure you will take pity on us and give it up. You must endure your sorrow, Uncle Vanya. You must endure it.
There it is. And now we must get to work at once, or else I shall not be able to endure it. To work.
Yes, we shall get to work just as soon as we've seen them all off. Everything is in a muddle.
Now I can be off.
Are you in here, Ivan? We're starting soon. Go to Alexander. He wants to speak to you.
Go, Uncle Vanya. Come, you and Papa must make peace. That's absolutely necessary. Come.
I'm going away. Goodbye.
So soon?
Carriage is waiting.
Goodbye. Were you frightened? Was it so terrible?
Yes.
Couldn't you stay? Couldn't you... Tomorrow, in the forest.
No, it is all settled. And that is why I can look you so bravely in the face. Our departure is fixed. One thing I must ask of you. Don't think too badly of me. I should like you to respect me. I shall take this pencil for memory.
How strange. We meet and then it seems we must part forever. That is the way in this world. As long as we're alone before Uncle Vanya comes in carrying a bouquet, allow me to kiss you goodbye, may I? So, splendid.
I wish you every happiness. For once in my life, I shall. I scorn the consequences. Must go.
Yes, if the carriage is waiting, then go at once. E finita la commedia.
Shame on him who bears malice for the past. I've gone through so much in these hours that I feel as if I could write a book on posterity for the instruction of your life. I gladly accept your apology, and I myself ask for your forgiveness.
Goodbye, Your Excellency. Don't forget us.
Goodbye. Goodbye. Thank you for your pleasant company.
I have a great regard for your opinions and enthusiasm. But let me, as an old man, give you a piece of advice. Do something. Work! Do something. Good luck to you all.
Come away.
Goodbye. Forgive me. I shall never see you again.
Goodbye, dear boy.
Tell them to bring my carriage around to Waffles.
All right, old man.
Why don't you go see the boy?
Let them go. I'm too sad. I must get to work at something at once. To work.
They have gone.
God be with them.
The professor, I suppose, is glad to go. He cannot be tempted back now by a fortune.
They have gone. Come, Uncle Vanya, let us do something.
To work.
It is long, long since you and I have sat together at this table. No ink? First, we must drop the accounts. They are in a terrible state. Come, begin.
An account with...
The Sandman has come.
How still it is. Their pens scratch. The cricket sings. It is so warm and comfortable. I hate to go. My carriage is here. There remains but to say goodbye to you all. And then away.
Don't hurry away. Sit a little longer with us.
Impossible.
And carry forward the old debt, 275.
When will you see us again?
Hardly before summer. But if anything should happen, you will let me know. Thank you for your kindness, for your hospitality, for everything. Goodbye, old nurse.
Won't you take a little tea?
I don't want any.
Won't you have a drop of vodka?
Yes, I might. My off-wheeler has gone lame for some reason. I noticed it last when Peter was taking it to water.
You should have him reshod.
Yes, I shall have to stop by the blacksmith on the way home. It can't be avoided.
Help yourself. To your good health. Eat your bread with it.
No, I like it so. And now I must be off. You needn't see me off, nurse.
On the 2nd of February, 20 pounds of butter. On the 16th, 20 pounds of butter again. Buckwheat flour.
He has gone.
Total 15, 25. The Lord have mercy. Oh, my child. I am miserable.
If only you knew how miserable I am.
What can we do? We must live our lives. Yes, Uncle Vanya, we shall live through the procession of days before us and the long evenings, and we shall patiently bear the trials that fate imposes upon us, and we shall work for others without rest, both now and when we are old, and when that last hour comes, we shall meet it humbly. And there beyond the grave we shall say that we have suffered and wept, and that our life was bitter. God will take pity on us. And we then will see that bright and beautiful life. We shall rejoice. We shall look back upon our sorrows here. A tender smile. And we shall rest. Oh, my poor, poor Uncle Vanya, you are crying. You have never known what happiness was. But wait, Uncle Vanya, wait. We shall rest. We shall rest. We shall rest.